Thank you. situations and in lives tonight. And we give you praise, and we give you thanks, and we give you glory. Come on, for these last few seconds, can you just worship God? Come on, can you use your voice and worship God? I love you, Jesus. I magnify you, Lord. You're great and you're greatly to be praised. There's nobody like you. I love you, Jesus. I adore you, oh precious God. Oh, clap your hands, all ye people, and shout to God with the voice of triumph. Are there any victorious people in the house of the Lord tonight? Come on, let the redeemed of the Lord say so.
Lord, I worship
my Prince of Peace.
My Prince of Peace.
And I worship.
I worship you.
Because of who you are. Oh, can you lift up your hands and worship God right now? Oh, I love you, Jesus. I worship you, God. Oh, can you thank the Lord for who He is? Can you thank God for what He's done for you? Can you lift up the name of Jesus Christ for His greatness? Oh, thank you, God, for your mercy and your love and your grace. Oh, thank you, Lord. 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 While we're in this spirit, if you have a need, let it be known by the lifting up of your hand. Let's remember Sister Bro, she's going for surgery tomorrow. We want to see a physician tomorrow. We want to keep her in our prayers. Those needs that are among us, let's remember them. Pray for our brothers and sisters. Let's remember our city and the work of Jesus Christ. Come on, can you lift up your voice? Let's pray right now. Lord Jesus, I'm praying that you would touch every need that's been made known in this house. God, I'm praying that you would be with Sister Bro. I'm praying for every other need that is among our congregation, Lord, that you would touch them and move in their situation. We're trusting and believing in you that you can do all things and that there is nothing that is too hard for you. And now, O Lord, we rejoice in knowing that you can meet our need. And we believe that you have heard our prayer tonight. If you believe God's heard your prayer and have enough faith to believe that He can do all things, can you lift up your voice and shout, thank you, Jesus.
Give him
Oh, you got a right to praise Him. You ought to praise the Lord. You ought to dance. You ought to shout. You ought to praise till the glory comes out. Hallelujah, Jesus. Lord, I praise You. I worship You, God. I magnify Your holy name, Lord. Lord, I love You, God. I need You every day of my life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, God, You are worthy. Hallelujah. God, hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Oh, God. Hallelujah. Thank You, Jesus. Oh, I need You, Jesus. Praise God. I don't know about you, but there's no place I'd rather be on a Wednesday night, oh God, than here in the presence of God Almighty. Hallelujah. A few announcements. All youth, we will not be having youth night this Friday due to being a holiday weekend. There'll be a bunch of them, y'all, that ain't going to be able to attend anyway. And Standing Firm Youth Rally. Remember that. Put the deal up. Everybody should make plans to come to this. I do believe the Lord's going to move in a mighty way. I really do. Thank You, Jesus. And all the youth, hear me. Hear this. Listen in ears on. If you're planning on going to Peak or camp, the deposits are due this Sunday morning, no later than Sunday morning. So if you're planning on going, make sure your deposit's done on by Sunday, and you can give that to Sister Michelle. Also, Kids Power Zone this Sunday, the Easter Power Zone, invite some kids to come. I believe the Lord can move in power zones too on little kids too. In the name of Jesus. And also, the youth will be having a car wash April the 6th. Lord willing, it doesn't rain, sleet, hail, thunderstorm. I was thinking the other day we should be like the USPS, rain, sleet, or snow. We're going to have this thing because it's done. Got us once. But right now, let the ushers come. We can go ahead and y'all can make your way back to your seats. The ushers can come as we get ready to give our tithes and our offerings. And let's go to prayer for our tithes and our offering. Lord Jesus, we thank You, Lord, once again, Lord, for the opportunity to be in Your house today, God. Lord, I ask, God, that You bless the offering, God, both the gift and the giver tonight, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Y'all come by and give Your offering. Oh,
clap your hands and give that mighty God a mighty big praise tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you have a songbook near you, turn to page 33. You may not need it, but we're going to sing just for a minute here. Praise God. I'm glad I got the Holy Ghost. If you're in the house tonight and you need the Holy Ghost, you can have it before you leave this house. I have found His grace is all complete. He supplieth every need. Oh. Got it in too high a gear. Let's try this again. I have found His grace is all complete. He supplieth every need. While I sit and learn at Jesus' feet, I am free as free indeed. Oh, it is joy unspeakable and full of glory, full of glory, full of glory. It is joy unspeakable and right, but something got a hold of me. I'm thankful something got a hold of me one day. Changed my life and turned it around. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Well, it's a thrill to be in the house of the Lord tonight. I was glad when they said unto me, it's church time, Wednesday night. Get to go to church. Praise God. Praise God. Genesis chapter number 37. And then we will go to Genesis chapter number 39. And then we'll be going to Genesis chapter number 41. Now, if the Lord will help me, I won't preach as long as my three texts indicate that I may. Typically, when a preacher takes a text from three or more passages of Scripture, people begin to worry. But I pray I won't be long. If you'll help me, I won't be long. Praise God. Genesis chapter number 37 and verse number 23. I believe that somebody's going to leave here encouraged today. I believe somebody's going to leave here empowered to do more for Jesus. Praise God. The 23rd verse of Genesis chapter number 23. The Bible says, and it came to pass when Joseph was come unto his brethren, that they stripped Joseph out of his coat of many colors that was on him. And they took him and cast him into the pit. And the pit was empty. There was no water in it. Genesis chapter number 39. Praise God. Verse number 19, we'll begin reading. And it came to pass, when his master heard the words of his wife, which she spake unto him, saying, after this manner did thy servant to me, that his wrath was kindled. And Joseph's master took him and put him into prison, a place where the king's prisoners were bound, and he was there in the prison. Finally, Genesis chapter number 41 and verse number 39. Everybody say the pit. Everybody say the prison. And let's read what happens in chapter number 41, verse number 39. The Bible says, and Pharaoh said unto Joseph, for as much as God hath showed thee all this, there is none so discreet and wise as thou art. Thou shalt be over my house, and according unto thy word shall all my people be ruled. Only in the throne will I be greater than you. And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, see, I have set thee over all the land of Egypt. And Pharaoh took off his ring from his hand and put it upon Joseph's hand and arrayed him in vestures of fine linen and put a gold chain about his neck. And he made him to ride in the second chariot which he had. And they cried before him, bow the knee. And he made him ruler over all the land of Egypt. We've so far tonight visited the pit. We visited the prison. And we visited the palace. I want to preach tonight on this thought. The pit, the prison, and the palace. Can you lift up your hands and just thank God for his word that's going to come forth today. And just thank God for what he's going to do in this house before we leave this place. God, I need you tonight. God, I need you tonight. Help me to preach your word. Help me to speak your word. Help me to think your thoughts and to speak your words. Anoint the ears of the hearer that they could hear, their hearts that they could receive. I pray, oh Lord God, that you would encourage somebody to do something for you and to be all that they can be for Jesus Christ. And we give you thanks and praise. And everybody said, in Jesus' name, clap your hands, lift up your voice, and give God praise one more time as you're seated. Praise God. I need you, Jesus. I need you, Jesus. God bless you. You can be seated. The pit, the prison, and the palace. I heard a story of a farmer who owned an old mule. And this mule was too old to work and too old to be sold. And the farmer got tired of constantly having to buy food to feed this mule and got tired of the mule just always being in the way. But this farmer didn't have the heart to shoot the old mule. And so he said, I'll just take him out into the pasture, and there's an old dry well there. So he took him out to the pasture and brought him to the side of this old dry well and pushed him in. And said, I'll just bury this mule and forget about him. So later on that evening, that old farmer brought a load of trash by and dumped it into the old dry well on top of the mule and took off back to the house for the evening. And in the bottom of that old dry well, that pit, if you would, the mule that the trash had landed on, he shook the trash off and stepped on it and kept on staying in the bottom of the pit. Time rocked on, and the old farmer brought an old fender by and threw it down in that pit. And it hit that old mule, and it hurt, but he shook it off and stepped on it. A few days later, the old farmer brought some rocks by and dumped it in this hole where this mule was that he was trying to bury. And the same thing, they hurt the mule. The mule didn't understand what was going on, but he just shook them off and stepped on it. Time rocked on. You get the pattern of what happens. And finally, this old farmer says, today's the day that this hole is going to be filled up, and I don't have to worry about this old mule anymore. He came with a load of dirt to seal off the hole, and he dumped it in the hole and then landed on the old mule, and he shook it off and he stepped on it, and he stepped out of that old dry well into the pasture and walked around in the pasture and drank of some fresh water out of the trough and kept on living. And what we learn from this story is that tribulation and being in the pit doesn't define who you are or where you go in God. In fact, it shows us that if you take what is thrown on you in the pit and shake it off and step on it, that you'll go higher in God. So we find Joseph was born of a man named Jacob and his wife, Rachel. He was the first son of Rachel's only two children. Joseph witnessed some things that the majority of people, and he witnessed all the major events in his father's life. He witnessed the departure from Laban's house. He witnessed Jacob's fear when it came time to meet Esau. He saw the difference in his father's walk one morning after Jacob had wrestled with the angel of the Lord. Joseph witnessed the brotherly embrace as Jacob and Esau were finally reunited after so many years of separation. He witnessed the brothers ruining his father's reputation by slaying Shechem and all the men in the city. Joseph witnessed his mother dying after giving birth to his younger brother Benjamin. But Joseph didn't start having experiences with God for himself until he was 17 years of age. He was in the field feeding the flock with his brothers, and Joseph brought unto his fathers, the Bible says, an evil report. Came back, and if you would, he was the tattletale of his brothers. And it's at this point that Scripture reveals to us that Jacob loves Joseph more than all of his brethren. And it's as if Scripture is inferring here that Joseph bringing an evil report to Jacob was the cause. Now, that can be debated, and that can be talked about, and that can be hashed out. But what we do know is that it's after this point that it's revealed to us that Jacob made Joseph a coat of many colors. Thus, his brothers saw it, and the Bible says they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. The hatred of them being replaced, the hatred of the knowledge that they might not ever could measure up in their father's eyes to Joseph. But if the coat of many colors wasn't enough, Joseph began to be used of God. In Genesis chapter number 37, the Bible says, and Joseph dreamed a dream. He says, hey brothers, you'll never guess what happened to me last night. Now tell us, Joseph. I had a dream. What was your dream? Well, you see, I dreamed that we were out in the field binding our sheaves together, and all of a sudden my sheaf stood upright and everybody else has bowed down to me. Can you imagine being a brother? You telling me that I'm going to bow down to you? I already don't like you because you're daddy's favorite. And now you're telling me I'm going to bow down to you. He said, well, that's what I dreamed. That's what I dreamed. And so time rocks on. And the Bible says they hated him the more for his dreams and for his words. And you keep on reading and we find that Joseph dreamed yet another dream. Everybody say another dream. He goes and tells his father about it, or his brothers about it. And he says, hey, had another dream. And they said, oh, let me guess, we're bowing to you again. Yeah, and the sun and the moon. Hey, you ought to go tell dad that. Okay. So here goes Joseph running back to his dad. And he says, hey, dad, I had a dream. Okay, tell me about it. Well, I was ascended up into heaven, okay? And all the stars bowed down to me. Well, that's all your brothers. Yeah, he said, and the sun and the moon bowed down to me also. Bible says that Jacob rebuked Joseph. He said, what do you think you're saying? You think me and your mama are going to bow down to you? You have lost your mind. Joseph said, well, that's what I dreamed. So there's friction, there's turmoil, there is conflict in the house. The brothers are going out to the fields to watch the shepherds, and or watch the sheep rather. And they have gone out, and Jacob says to Joseph, excuse me, he says, go out and check on your brothers. I want to know how they're doing. I want to know what they're up to, if everything is well with them. Joseph makes his way out to the field where his brothers are. And the Bible says that somebody found him just wandering around. You can go read it for yourself, but they say that the Bible says that he was wandering. And they ask him, what are you doing? He said, I'm looking for my brothers. And they directed him in the direction where his brothers were. And when they saw him coming, they said, oh, here comes that dreamer. Here comes that guy with all the multicolored coat who dreams that all his family's going to bow down to him. Here comes that guy that thinks he's better than us. Here comes that apostolic. Here comes that one God man. Here comes that Jesus name lady. Here comes that self-righteous Pentecostal. Here comes a dreamer, the one that is used of God. Genesis chapter number 37 and 20 says, Come now therefore, these are the brothers speaking. It said, and cast him into some pit. Let's kill him and let's cast him into the pit. And we will say, some evil beast hath devoured him. And we shall see what will become of his dreams. Okay, Joseph, you think you're going to dream? You think you're going to tell us that we're going to bow down to you? We'll show you what we think of your dreams, and we're going to kill you, and we're going to throw you in a pit, and then we'll see what happens. You can read all the fine details, but his brother Reuben took up for him and said, no, let's not kill him. I'm fine with us throwing him in a pit, but let's not kill him. And it satisfied his brothers. And so when he came to them, Bible tells us when he came to them, in verse number, there around in verse number 20, somewhere around in there, the Bible says that they stripped him of his coat first. See, let me back up. When they said that, here comes that dreamer, it reminded me of something that was said of the saints in the book of Acts. People are gathered around and they're hearing about what's going on and revival's breaking out. People getting the Holy Ghost and people are being healed and people are being delivered. And it was said of the saints in the book of Acts, these that have turned the world upside down are come hither also. There should be something about a child of God that causes us to dream, to never become stagnant, to never lose our spiritual drive, and to always want more of God. There's something about the fact that Jesus Christ, God Himself, is on your side, that you just have some passion and some zeal and some dreams. When you come to the house of the Lord, you say, I wonder what's going to happen when I walk through those doors. I just can't wait to see what God is going to do. I know that He wants to do something great. And it's not just limited to these four walls, but God has great things in store. Clap your hands and praise God. There's also something about the fact that God is on your side that some people are just going to hate you for it. Some people are just going to despise you because God is with you. It's just the way it works. There's people that'll be against you because God's on your side. I've got anybody that knows what I'm talking about today. There's going to be some people that just, you come in the room and they, there's that dreamer. There's that apostolic. Oh, but I'll address that in a minute. So Joseph comes to his brothers. They strip him of his coat. They thought that the calling of God was limited to the things that He had on this earth. They didn't realize that His power wasn't, and His calling wasn't wrapped up in a coat of many colors. But it was because the Lord had put His hand upon them. It wasn't simply because of the status that He had in the world. It's because God Himself had chosen him. How many times we as Christians often associate the calling of God with things that we have in this natural world. And if the evangelist, that's me, doesn't have such and such and so, the calling of God is not on his life. Oh, but can I tell you that God Himself chose and chooses people not because of what they have, not because of what they do, not because of who they are, but because they're just a willing vessel who says, God, if you can use anything, you can use me. May I pause here and say, if you have a desire to be used of God, it doesn't have to be tied up in anything in this natural world. But if you can find yourself in a place of prayer and say, God, I want you to use me in any way you see fit. God, I know I might not have everything together and I might not have everything that I'm supposed to have according to the status quo, but all I've got is a willing heart and saying, God, if you can use me, I'll dream a dream. God, if you can use me, I'll have a dream and I'll fight and I'll work until it comes to pass. Now we find that Joseph is in the bottom of a pit with no food or water. And Joseph, although his brothers did not kill him in that instance, their long-term plan and the long-term action was murder to their brother. His brothers, his church family, his closest friend, his own blood kin have mocked him because he's dreaming. They've not only mocked him, but they have doubted that he can be what God wants him to be. I've heard too many times, and once is enough for it to be too many times, but I've heard people say, oh, he don't have everything together. She don't have everything together. She can't do, she can't be, he can't do, he can't be what God's called him to be. My friend, as long as you have the ability to dream, you can be what God wants you to be. As long as you have the ability to say, God, you can use me. I'll be what you've called me to be. They have ridiculed Joseph for dreaming big. They ridiculed Joseph for having too big of a dream. You think your own father is going to bow down to you? No, I don't think it. That's just what I dreamed. And if God gave me a dream, somehow it's going to come to pass. I may not understand it. This is the calling that God has given to me. And these people who he trusted most are looking at him in the bottom of a pit saying, what about your dreams now, Joseph? They're throwing some trash down on him. Said, what you going to do about it now? The old fender hurts, don't it, Joseph? What you going to do about your dreams now? I could see Joseph down in the bottom of the pit. I don't know how far it was, but if they threw him in here, he probably was hurting. He probably had some bruises. He probably was aching, but I can hear Joseph saying, I've got a word from God, and I'm going to hold on to it. I've had a dream that sometime, somehow in my life, something great is going to happen for me. And Joseph didn't know it, but there still was a palace in his future. Just because he was in the pit did not negate the fact that there was a palace still in his future. Just because he might have been in the pit with no water and no food, and his family were laughing at him and mocking him and saying, your dreams will never come to pass now. You're just going to sit in the bottom of the pit and you're going to die. Joseph's future, his calling, his purpose in the kingdom of God was not forfeited because he was in the bottom of the pit. Did not negate the fact. It did not cancel the palace. The pit did not cancel the palace. This was just a step in the journey for Joseph to become the provider for the very ones who were standing there mocking him. They could not have known it that day, but there would come a day when Joseph would have the authority to say, hey brothers, what about your dreams now? What you going to do about the famine that's going on right now? How you going to provide? What you going to do? Remember when you threw me in the pit? You know, I ought to just send you back and let you starve to death. And no, I won't kill you, but the long-term plan is murder. But we know the story, Joseph didn't do that. The dreams, the aspirations, the spiritual goals, the calling of God is not, everybody say it's not, not determined by what the people closest to you may say. Thank God. I'm thankful that the calling of God, the things that have been said that would be fulfilled in our spiritual lives are not determined, are not, they do not hinge on the fact of what other people have to say about it. I gotta be careful right here. But it's determined by the God who breathed life into your lungs. Your future in the kingdom of God is determined by God and your willingness to fulfill it. The only person who can stop you from fulfilling the things that God has called you to do is you. There's only one human in the world who can cancel the purpose of God in your life. And it's you. It's the person you look at every morning when you wake up. And you look in the mirror as you're brushing your teeth. You're the only person. Joseph, in this moment at the bottom of the pit, could have canceled everything. He said, oh, okay, you know what? I'm done. Throw in the towel. It's over for me. There's no way my dreams can come to pass. But here he was in the bottom of the pit. Joseph is sold to Midianites, merchant men. And the report is brought back to Jacob. We found this coat. Do you recognize it? Said, yeah, that's Joseph's coat. It's got blood on it. Oh, Joseph! In this moment, he believes, he is convinced that Joseph has been mauled by a wild animal and killed. And Joseph is no longer on the earth. And the Bible says that Jacob refused to be comforted. He refused to be comforted. But meanwhile, Joseph hasn't been mauled by a wild animal. He's in a caravan on his way to Egypt. And when they get to Egypt, Joseph is sold to Potiphar. And Potiphar puts him to work. He says, okay, here's what you're going to do, and here's how you're going to do it. Potiphar is the captain of the guard. He's a man with power and with authority. In Genesis chapter number 39, beginning with verse number 2, the Bible says, and the Lord was with Joseph. So Joseph has come out of the pit. Here we are in Genesis chapter number 39. He's sold to Potiphar, and the Lord is with Joseph. And he was a prosperous man. And he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. And his master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord made all that he did to prosper in his hand. And Joseph found grace in his sight, and he served him, and he made him overseer over his house, and all that he put into his hand. And it came to pass from that time, everybody say from that time, that he had made him overseer in his house. From the moment that Potiphar said, okay, Joseph, you're going to oversee everything that goes on in my household. Everything that I've got going on, you're in control of it now. We'll have meetings every Monday morning, and you'll tell me what's going on, and I'll see you again next Monday. From the moment that happened, and over all that he had, that the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. Because Joseph, oh Lord, help me to preach this tonight, how I feel it. Because Joseph didn't give up in the pit. Here he is in Potiphar's house. He's busy about doing what needs to be done. He says, I don't really know if I'm supposed to be here or not, but this is where I am in this season, so I'm going to be busy about what I've got to do. I'm going to take care of this for Potiphar. I'm going to do this. And from the moment he was made overseer, there was blessings poured out on Potiphar's house because Joseph was there. There are some things that happen on your job and for your boss and for the place that you work, blessings that are poured out on them just simply because you're there. Doesn't have anything to do with anybody else. It's just because you're there. And if you weren't there, they wouldn't have gotten what they got, the blessing that they received. But because Joseph's in Potiphar's house, there's blessings that are poured upon Potiphar's house. And the blessing of the Lord was upon all that he had in the house and in the field. So here's Potiphar. The Bible says he don't even know what he's got except the food that he eats. He checks in with Joseph every once in a while to kind of see how things are going. Hey, Joseph, how are things? Man, Potiphar, let me tell you. No, I don't want to know. You got it. Just if anything goes wrong, tell me. But as long as everything's going good, let's have at it. And you know what? If anything goes wrong, you handle it. Don't even tell me about it. Potiphar don't even know. He just knows he's blessed. Potiphar's satisfied. Potiphar's ecstatic. Potiphar is glad that Joseph is in his house. But there's one person who's not satisfied with what's going on. There's always got to be that one person, Brother Leger. Everything's going to be going so well, and there's always going to be that one person. Oh, I don't know. You know, that apostolic. So here we go. Potiphar's wife shows up on the scene. She begins to entice Joseph, and she begins to work on Joseph. But Joseph had a made-up mind. No, I got a promise. I've got a dream. There's a palace in my future. And he says, I'm not going to defile myself. I'm not going to sin against God or your husband. Your husband has given me everything that I could imagine. There's something about when you're going through things that when you come out of it. Now, let me tell you the reason why Joseph went through the pit. Because if he'd have gone from Jacob's house to Potiphar's house, and there would have been no pit in the middle, Joseph would have thought that he made it there on his own. If it would have been from Jacob to Potiphar, Joseph would have said, oh, look what I did. Made it to Potiphar's house. But because he went to the pit, it made him to realize, you know, there was a time I was in a pit and I wasn't overseeing everything in Potiphar's house. Look what the Lord has done. Can I tell you, there's some things we go through just simply so we can focus on the blessings of God and see the goodness of God. There are some things in life that we go through that it's just a stop along the journey. But what it's trying to get us to do is focus on the goodness of God. And Joseph said, okay, because God has been so good to me, I can't allow myself to sit back in my spiritual lazy chair. I didn't get here on my own. I can't take things into my own hands. And if I take them into my own hands, I'll take them out of the hands of God. If I become complacent here and let down my guard, I'm liable to mess up. No, can't do that. God brought me where I am. I can't go. He put me in this position. Don't have anything to do with me. It's because the hand of the Lord is on me. It's because I have a dream. It's because God gave me a dream and I want it to come to pass. I came out of the pit and I'm in Potiphar's house. I had nothing to do with what I did, but everything to do with God. And so Potiphar's wife looks at Joseph and things escalate. Joseph takes off from the room and is left. Potiphar's wife is left with his coat. And so she screams and she begins to make accusations. And she begins to scandalize his name. And she begins to get in Potiphar's ear and begin to say, you know that apostolic that you hired on the job a few years back? Look what he's done. Look what they messed up. Look at what they've done. And she convinces Potiphar that her story is true. And now we find Joseph, the man who when he was in his household was blessed, is now telling his guards, take him and throw him in the king's prison. So here's Joseph. So I was in the pit, and then I'm in Potiphar's house. Everything was going fine and dandy. And then that one person showed up. Now I'm in the prison on something that didn't even happen. So now Joseph had the opportunity. Joseph had the opportunity to sit and rot in his jail cell. Say, okay, well, I thought this was the dream, the fulfillment of the dream. But now I'm in prison. So I'm just going to sit here and rot. I'm going to sit here and pout. I'm going to sit here. I'm just going to let the world go by. And my dream will never be fulfilled. No. Joseph had the same mentality. He said, here I am in prison. What can I do? Hey, jailer, you got a broom? This cell is filthy. So he began working. He began doing stuff. Hey, I'm going to polish up these bars for you. The jailer took notice and he said, hey, Joseph, come here. He said, I'm going to put you over the affairs of this prison. Now imagine a prisoner running the prison. If I was Joseph, I'd have opened every door and we'd all be gone. Said, I'm out of here. I'll still away you. Here we go. Here's Joseph. He put his mind to work. He decided he wasn't going to sit there and rot, but he was going to be something good. And he's in this prison with the realization, I have a dream. I've received a dream. and I'm going to see it come to pass. Joseph's in the prison. He's put in prison. But verse number 21 of Genesis chapter number 39 says, but the Lord was with Joseph and showed him mercy and gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. So he set over the affairs of the prison. Why? Because the Lord was with Joseph. We may not be where we want to be, but can I remind you, we still have work to do. You may not be in the position that you want to be in. You may not hold the career that you desire. You may not even be working in the department that you signed the application for. But you still got work to do. Ye are the light of the world. Let your light so shine before men. I may hate my job. I may despise what I'm doing. I've been put there for a purpose. The pit, Potiphar's house, and then the prison. Joseph was in the prison not as a cancellation of the fulfillment of his promise, but as a setup for the fulfillment of his dream. This prison experience would take him higher. May I submit to you that the pit and the prison are not here to harm you, but they are here to send you higher and your relationship with God. If Joseph would have been in prison, he would not have been in prison. He would not have interpreted any dreams. And if he would not have interpreted the butler and the baker's dreams, he wouldn't have stood before Pharaoh and ultimately ended up in the prison. Joseph could have had the mentality, well, my dream hasn't come to pass yet, so why should I help anybody else's be fulfilled? I haven't seen my dream come to pass yet, so why should I assist the butler and the baker in their interpretation? Why should I help further their dream? Why should I invest my time and my effort and my prayer and my dedication in what they want to see done? But Joseph wasn't a dream killer. He was a dream chaser. And he had to learn, in order for my dream to be fulfilled, I have to help others fulfill their dream. Joseph knew what it felt like to be surrounded by dream killers. He knew what it felt like for somebody to go, we'll see what becomes of your dream. So Joseph said, no, I'm not going to be like that. Tell me your dream. What did you dream? I have some experience with dreams, Joseph said. I have just a little bit of experience. That's what got me here. So here he is. Butler, and I'm hurrying. Butler and the baker give him his dream. The butler's dream was good. And the baker said, okay, so his interpretation was good, so let me tell Joseph. Well, that wasn't the case for the baker. The butler is told, hey, in 3 days you're going to be restored to your position. But the baker said, in 3 days you're going to be hanging from the tree outside. Ooh. So Joseph said, hey, I didn't write it. I just delivered the mail. So here he is. 3 days later, it's Pharaoh's birthday. He says, hey, let's have a party. Get the butler and the baker back out here. Let's have a conversation with them. And I don't know if it was by vote, if they had to make a sales pitch, whatever it was. But just as Jacob had interpreted the dreams, the Bible says that's what happened. How Joseph interpreted the dreams. The butler was restored and the baker was hung. But back up a little bit. Joseph looks at the butler and he says, hey, when you're restored to your position, Brother Butler, remember old Joseph down here in the prison? Tell Pharaoh, you know, when Potiphar had this man working for him that everything he did was blessed by the hand of the Lord, and Pharaoh's house was thriving and everything was going good, and then everything crashed and burned. Right before Everything crashed and burned. Potiphar's wife lied on me, and that's why I'm here in prison. Tell Pharaoh this story, and he'll get me out of jail. This is the moment when Joseph decided to take things into his own hands. If I can connect with the right person, I'll get out of this prison. If I can buddy up to the right people, everything will be all right. If I can get a word into the right person's ear, I'll get out of this prison. And the moment that we start messing with what we think is a natural timeline, we get our hands involved, we start messing with God's timeline. And I don't have any evidence to back this up, but could it be that Joseph would have got out of prison a whole lot sooner than 2 years if he'd have just let everything be? Because it was 2 years later. The Bible says Pharaoh dreamed a dream. Notice, after Joseph's second dream, we don't read that Joseph dreamed anything else. But it's the butler, the baker, and the Pharaoh. Joseph had to make up in his mind, I'm going to help everybody else see the fulfillment of their dream. And somehow, some way, sometime, my dream will be fulfilled. So time rocks on. 2 years later, Pharaoh has dreamed a dream, and the butler standing off in the corner waiting for an order for Pharaoh. And he pipes up. He says, hey, Pharaoh, I know you can't find an interpretation of this dream, but I know a guy who, you remember when you threw me in prison 2 years ago? I had a dream about you restoring me, and he interpreted the dream to me. And I imagine he's probably still in prison, because I was supposed to tell you about him, I forgot. So Pharaoh says, okay, get him, bring him up here. Now, Joseph has another decision to make. It's been 13 years. By this time, Joseph is 30 years old. It's been 13 years since he's had his first dream. And in those 13 years, he's been in a pit surrounded by dream killers. God has lifted him up out of the pit into a powerful position at Potiphar's house, only to be put in prison helping others with their dreams. In 13 years, Joseph has been abused. He's been mistreated. He's been given up for dead. He's been lied on. He's been scandalized. He's been defamed. He's been forgotten about. And now he has an opportunity to appear before Pharaoh. Okay, Joseph, what you gonna do? Well, I could just sit here and tell Pharaoh I'm not coming. And then I could say that the butler lied and I never interpreted a dream for him, and then Pharaoh would kill him and be done with him. So he had a choice to make. What am I going to do? He said, no, I've got a dream. I got a dream. And I can't forfeit it for anything. He said, it's been 13 years since I dreamed a dream, and I thought it was coming to fulfillment, but the pit was just a step along the journey, and this prison may be the same thing as the pit. After all I did for the butler, he forgot about me. I cannot believe it. But Joseph rose above the childness of pouting over not yet fulfilled dreams and interpreted the dream of Pharaoh. And we read in our final text in Genesis chapter number 41 and verse number 38. And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, forasmuch as God hath showed thee all this, there is none so discreet and wise as thou art. Thou shalt be over my house. So here's Joseph standing in front of the ruler of the most powerful kingdom on earth at that time. And he's just shaved his face because he's grown 2 years worth of beard because they wouldn't allow razors in prison. He says, he just offered me to rule his whole house. I've been in the pit. I've been in the prison. Now I'm standing in the palace with an offer that there's no way I could pass up. I'm hurrying, I promise. Throughout the 13 years it took Joseph to fulfill his dreams, he encountered things that he never thought he would encounter. But now He's standing in front of Pharaoh. And Pharaoh has just made him ruler over all the land of Egypt. From the pit to the prison to the palace. Somehow, if we can get a hold, I've got a dream. I don't know how it's going to come to pass. I don't know when it's going to come to pass. But I've got a promise from God that I'm going to do something great for him. If I'll just stay willing, if I'll just stay in his hand, if I'll just stay doing the right things, somehow, somewhere, sometime, it's going to come to pass. I may go through the pit, but that doesn't define me. I may be in the prison, but that doesn't end my dream. I'm going to keep on dreaming. I'm going to keep on dreaming. I've simply stopped by on Wednesday night to tell someone that there is a palace in your future. Don't let the pit kill your dreams, and don't let the prison make you bitter, but keep on dreaming, baby. Keep on dreaming. You're gonna have the opportunity to get bitter. Oh, help me, Lord. You're gonna have the opportunity to say, well, bless God, I don't think that they can do it. If my dream hasn't been fulfilled yet, theirs for sure ain't. I've been in this truth for 743 years. And it ain't come to pass for me. And they've been in the church for 2 months. And they're seeing great things happen. You'll have the opportunity to say, there is no way I'm going to pray for their healing. So I've been dealing with this situation for too long, and God has not touched me yet. Oh, come on, somebody. Hallelujah. I've been dealing with this for too long, and these people want me to pray for them. But if you get the mentality of Joseph, if I can help Brother Kelly fulfill his dreams, there'll be something that happens in the heavenly arena that says, oh, he's helping somebody else. So, here's Joseph in the palace. Time rocks on, and I'm closer to being finished than I was when I started. Joseph says, okay, here's what's going to happen, Pharaoh. And he helps in the years of plenty gather everything in. And the years of famine come, and he is rationed out food, and his brothers come before him, and you know the story. Before it's all said and done, his brothers have bowed down before him. He's been reunited with his brothers, and he has put them in a place where they can live and in a place where they will thrive, and the children of Israel will get their start. If you remember, they're brought to Goshen, and Joseph dies. And then there arises a Pharaoh that knew not Joseph. And the children of Israel have grown and multiplied. They never moved. And it was because Joseph didn't get bitter in the pit. He didn't get bitter in the prison. And when he made it to the palace, he said, okay, I've got a choice. I can either take vengeance on my brothers, or I can bless them. I can either end my brother's life, or I can say, you know what? What you meant for evil, God meant for good. I can either say, you know, I'm sick and tired of you. Get out of here and do something for your own self. Or I can say, hey, you know what? I knew this day would be coming, and I had a dream, but I'm not going to get bitter over it. I'm going to say, you know what? I may not understand how the pit had anything to do with it, but here I am. Romans says it this way, for I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. You may be going through the deepest, darkest trial of your life, but there's a palace in your future. Don't let the dream die. Don't let the dream die. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. Clap your hands and praise God right now. Keep on dreaming. You've been called. Keep on dreaming. You've been chosen. Keep on dreaming. You're a royal priesthood. There's a palace in your future. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation? Shall tribulation? Or distress? Or, oh, I'll say it like you mean it. Or persecution? Or famine? Our nakedness, our peril, our sword. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him that loved us. Keep dreaming. Keep dreaming. You may go in the pit and you may end up behind prison bars, but there's still a palace in your future. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come. Nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able. Shall. I want everybody in the room to say it with feeling. Nothing can do it. There's nothing that shall separate us from the love of God. I just simply come to encourage somebody. You might not be in the pit, you might be under the pit. And you're looking up at the bottom of the pit. But just because you're in the pit and trash has been thrown down on you, you know what you do? You shake it off and step on it. Oh, they lied on me. Oh, scandalized my name. Hey, those rocks hurt. Can we be real? Those rocks hurt. But we still got a duty. And if we want to see our dream come to pass, you got to shake it off. And step on it. Keep dreaming, saint of God. Keep watching for that promise to come to pass. Oh, you keep believing for that. You might be in the prison polishing the bars, but you keep believing that God's going to heal your body. You might be interpreting somebody else's dream and praying with somebody else's family member that's praying through. Ooh, that got close to home right there. You might be witnessing somebody else's family member speaking in tongues and making an entrance into the house of God. But don't let it kill your dream. Just keep on dreaming. You may be sold as a slave, but don't lose sight of your promise. You may be in Potiphar's house, but don't get comfortable. This isn't the fulfillment. You may be lied on, but keep on dreaming. You may be talked about, but keep on dreaming. You may have been counted out, but those people can't count anyways. When the old farmer comes by with his old beat up dump truck to dump a load of trash on you, Brother Leger, there's a palace in my future. There's a palace in my future. And I'm holding on to a promise that God has given to me, that I won't always be in the pit. My destiny's not in the prison. But somewhere there's a palace waiting for me. And somewhere there's a fulfillment of my dream. I wonder if there's anybody in the house tonight that has a promise from God, who says, I may be in a prison right now, but I know that my promise is still on its way. I may not can line myself up exactly with God's timeline, and I may not understand why I am where I am, but I know there's a palace in my future. If that's you, I wonder if you could lift up your hands and just rejoice in the Lord, the God of your salvation. who breathed life into you, and will see this dream come to pass. And lift up your voice and praise God right now. Come on, Joseph, keep dreaming. Come on, Joseph, don't lose a dream. Come on, Joseph, in the prison, keep dreaming. In the pit, keep dreaming. When your brother's a lion, keep dreaming. When Potiphar's wife is scandalizing your name, keep dreaming. When Potiphar is giving up all hope in you, keep dreaming. So here's what I want us to do. As I'm done, I went way over time. Please forgive me. I won't do it again, I promise. But if you're in the pit and the weight of the world has just been dumped on your shoulders and everything in your job is not working out how it needs to be and they're plotting against you and they're saying, you know what? I'm sick and tired of this apostolic being here. I'm sick and tired of him coming in here and proclaiming his dream to me and giving me a church card and inviting me to the house of God. What I want us to do is they're going to sing in just a minute and less than a minute. And you're going to get opportunity to come up here. Shake it off and step on it. And here is where Paul and Silas got the revelation of what to do in the prison. Bonds and stocks in the inner cell, in the inner prison. Been lied on for dreaming. And they prayed and sang praises. The appropriate response to the pit and the prison, how you get in the palace, is what you do when you're in the pit and the prison. And if you praise, if you pray and sing praises, God will work in your favor. Come on, they're going to sing, and this is your opportunity to worship God. Come on, they're scandalizing you, but there's a palace in your future. They're running down your name, but there's a palace in your future. They're saying all these things against you, but there's a palace in your future. All things work together for the good of them who are called.
When the bottom falls out, even then I will praise him. When I can't figure it out, even then I will praise him. I know God is working.
There's a palace in my future. Come on, that's it. Shake it off and step on it. Devil, you're a liar. You're defeated. You're under my feet.